welcome to our final presentation. We are also part of the International Student Design Program. Today we'll be presenting our project on a new aqueduct system for a community called Vallecito, located in Panama. My name is Val, this is Lynn, and that is Victor. So today we will start with some team introductions and then go over kind of like where we traveled to in Panama. We'll give some information on the community and its background. They do have an existing system in place, however, we'll talk about why it's failing to meet the needs of the members. We'll go over our new design and the project details associated with it. We will go over our final recommendations for the project, and then conclude and have the team. So we developed a team name for the project. We're Misión de Agua Corriente, which stands for the Running Water Commission. Lynn here is our project manager. So within Panama, the red arrow and dot is about where we were. Exact locations on a map was hard to do. We took about a 2.5 hour road trip out to our community and then had about another hour and a half hike into the community of Vallecito. We traveled with another team, as Dr. Watkins already mentioned, Agua de Abajo, who will be presenting next. As he said also, we focused mainly on the southern half of the community and its systems there. And we will also be presenting the community information in order to avoid the WC. So here are some pictures of the landscape of Vallecito. As you can see, it's very hilly, lots of green vegetation everywhere. There are numerous stream crossings and even river crossings, which made it pretty difficult. The community itself, they settled the area about 70 years ago, and currently there's about 70 or more households in the area. They usually live in wooden huts and they have pipa chains available for use. They established a school in around the year 1948, and they have a church in the central town area, mainly used for central gatherings and meetings of this sort. And they have local stores where they sell cold beverages and some snacks. The people themselves are of Latino descent. They mainly speak Spanish and they rely heavily on agriculture. A lot of the people there are subsistence farmers, so they mainly grow what they eat. However, some families are able to make about $5 a day harvesting their crops. They mainly grow coffee, bananas, oranges, rice, and they have a lot of cows roaming everywhere, and they also have a lot of chickens. As far as activities go, they're really into baseball, swimming, and dancing.
Like Val said, there are existing systems. There's about 13 that we counted, and they're scattered throughout the community. The problems are many with these existing systems. Most of them were built 20 years ago or even longer ago. They're built by private families. They serve households, also the public facilities, but only 1 to 2 households typically. And they should be buried, but in reality, they're also not buried. And it's pretty difficult soil and terrain conditions. As you saw on the map in the previous slide, the layout is pretty decentralized. There's no single main with branching service lines coming off. It's just basically a service line between a source and a house. With the sources are virtually all of them are unprotected. There's species everywhere from the animals, so they're exposed and susceptible to E. coli contamination, runoff from pesticides and fertilizers. Of course, households without taps in their homes must walk some distance to the sources. And we found that basically nobody practices household treatment of any kind of water. Here's a map showing the levels of service in the community. There's quite a bit of bucket carrying households. There's only a few with acceptable service, and the improvements required is kind of in between. That could be walking a little bit of ways to all the way into the forest, or maybe their aqueduct is more preferred. The town center poses its own problems. Its source is located on private land, which isn't necessarily a problem in and of itself, but the developer of that land, the owner wants to develop it into farmland. He's going to use pesticides. That's considered a threat to the source. The public facilities are the Bell State School, the church, and public meeting area.
So the goal of our new design was to create a water system to serve all of Southern Vallecito. This includes all the houses south of the town center and the town center itself we are trying to serve with the system. We wanted to design a main aqueduct system to run from the source all the way to the town center with several service lines that branch off of this. And we would like some sort of inline fluorination for the system as they currently have no water treatment. And we'd also like the water committee to be more involved with the water system in the village. So while we were in Panama, the main task we completed was surveying. We surveyed using a water level. There are several houses near the end of the system that we were concerned that they may be higher than the tank itself and that it would be difficult to serve them with water. So the water level is slightly more accurate than the other methods of surveying we had. So the water level consists of a PVC tube, as you can see being held there, that's full of water, and then about a 20 feet long plastic tube that runs down the bottom, and then it runs up this stick over here that also has a measuring tape on it. So how you survey with the water level is you start by holding the stick and the PVC tube together, and you can record the elevation of the water in the tube. And then you move the appropriate end forward. So you're going to move the tube with the water forward, and then the stick will be back. And you can measure the distance in between the stick and the tube. And then you measure the new elevation reading in the stick. And then we took compass readings at every location that we surveyed at, and we also took GPS waypoints when needed. And then we repeated, and our community, our service line was about 4.5 kilometers long, so we had about 600 data points from surveying. So when we came back to the United States, this is the profile we created with our survey data. The blue line in the back is the line with all of the original 600 data points. And we modified this because 600 data points was a lot to work with. So the red line on top is the modified line. And as you can see, it really closely is close to our original data. And some significant points on this map are the source is up here, about 500 meters away from the source is the tank. And then there's several houses. When we were in Panama, surveying with the water level was really slow, so we were unable to survey all the service lines. We could only survey the main system. However, Agua de Abajo did survey one line for us, so we have survey information for the cemetery line.
Okay, so at this point we've covered what we did down in Panama, but to move on to the actual design of our aqueduct system. But before we do that, I'd like to explain to you some of the supply and demand numbers we have behind that design. First of all, we estimated there's 50 households. It's a pretty generous estimate that includes households that are going to be built in the near future, and 6 people per household. It's also a pretty generous estimate. The Ministry of Health, another group, mentioned it was 30 gallons per day per person in Panama. That's probably more than necessary, but it's still a good estimate. It's a good goal to provide people with. The total daily demand came out to almost 10,000 gallons per day. That includes residential and public facilities. The good thing is, in our worst case scenario, dry season flow is about 13,000 gallons per day. That's dry season, lowest time of the year.
So when we originally arrived in Panama, our plan was to survey just one line, which would run from the source all the way down to the town center. And it would run kind of along a ridge, so we called it the High Line. However, when we returned to the United States, we heard from our Peace Corps volunteer that they might not be running the system all the way down to the town center. So this is how I created the two options. So option one runs from the source to the tank, and then the High Line, as we call it, all the way to the town center. And this will have several service lines off of it that will serve all of the houses on the southern side of Vallecito. They're not shown on here because we were unable to serve them. Option two runs from the source to the tank, and then it only runs to some houses that are near the top. So from here, it's just downhill all the way to town center, but we're just running this line to the houses near the end of the system. And then this system connects to an existing system, as you can see, to an existing system that'll be worked on more, and that'll serve all of the rest of Southern Vallecito, and it will connect to the town center. So option one served all of Southern Vallecito, and option two, the line that we designed, only serves about 6 houses and connects to an existing system to serve the rest of Southern Vallecito. So option one is 4.2 kilometers, and option two is 3.5 kilometers long. This is our profile for option one. As I mentioned before, it runs from the source to the tank, and way to the town center, which is down here. The one problem we have with this system right now is the cemetery line is below the pressure limit line. Below this line, the pressure is really high, and we don't want to tee into the system here because of high pressure to create a weak point at the tee. However, when we were surveying, we didn't follow any paths when we were surveying. We were just going along where our guides were macheting out a path for us. So most likely when this is built, it will not be built along the same exact path that we surveyed. So most likely this will be a little bit higher and will be above the line, so there won't be a problem with teeing into the system there. And this is option two. As you can see, it doesn't run all the way down the hill here to the town center. So it just runs from the source of the tank to some houses at the end of the system here. And this is where it tees into the existing system. So for pipe sizing, the conduction line, the line from the source to the tank for both of the systems, is 1.5 inch SDR 13.5 pipe. For option one, the line that serves all the way down to the town center, that is 2 inches of SDR 26 pipe, and service lines off of this system are 1/2 inch of SDR 13.5 pipe. For option two, the line to where it connects to the existing system is 3 inches of SDR 26, and the rest of the line to the houses near the end of the system is 2 inches of SDR 26 pipe, and service lines once again are 1/2 inch.
So every water system needs a source. Our source is a spring source, and it's currently being protected by a spring box. This spring box was already previously constructed by a Peace Corps member of late August in 2012. And as Lynn already mentioned, a conduction line needs to be built in order to connect the spring box to the storage tank, which will be 1.5 inches of SDR 26.
Storage tank was also already built as a volume of 15 cubic meters. It was built also by the previous Peace Corps volunteer. And its purposes are twofold. First of all, it should, of course, store enough water for peak demand. But second of all, it should provide contact time for disinfection, for chlorination. But it was, in fact, only designed for the first purpose, for storing heat in 20 years in the future. This is our rendering of it. We didn't have a picture.
So in terms of water treatment, the community would like to use an inline chlorination system. We recommend the community construct a model similar to the one up here. It has baffles and weir components in there. The baffle in the beginning directs the flow towards the middle of the chlorinator, and it also has more controlled flow coming into the system. The two boreholes beneath there allow some of the water to come beneath the support plate there where the tablets will be resting upon. This will allow for not all the water to be in contact with the chlorine in order to modify how much chlorine is coming into the system. These slits here also allow for the chlorine to be controlled as it is being released into the water. And then the weir here at the end allows for more controlled release of the water into the storage tank. The tablets highlighted in red to the left there are the biggest size that the community will be using. They're about 2.5 to 3 inches in diameter, and they will be given to the community by the Ministry of Health located in Panama.
Air release valves. These are for usually high points in the system where air is trapped and water can't get through because the air is blocking it. This was our simple solution. This is what we approximated the dimensions of a PVC tee here and had a plastic stopper ball that simply moves up and down if there's air in the system or not. When there's air, the ball will float on the water surface and the air can escape into the atmosphere. And when there is no air in the system, it rises up to block that hole up there, and so that water won't escape. This is a brake pressure tank. Brake pressure tanks are basically for the opposite reason. This is usually system low points, but there's excess pressure. You can have pipe bursts. It's a masonry and reinforced concrete box that allows the water to be exposed to the atmosphere so that it can release pressure. And the inflow should be equally outflow, of course. It is pretty expensive components because of all the materials and time consuming to build before deployment.
So after we designed the brake pressure tanks and the air release valves, we looked at locations in the system where these were needed. So as you can see, the red triangle is the air release valves, and there are a lot of them right now located on this map. Ideally, when it's built, it will not be built along the same profile, so there will try to minimize the amount of significant elevation changes, so there won't be as many high points. And brake pressure tanks are the blue triangles. And as I mentioned earlier, we were concerned with low pressures near the end of the system. So we were unable to put any brake pressure tanks from the tank to the end of the system because that would reduce the pressure and we wouldn't have enough pressure to serve the houses at the top of the system. So the only brake pressure tanks are located as the path runs down to the town center. And there's also a brake pressure tank located right before the chlorination, because when the water goes into the chlorinator, it should impact pressure with it. So.
Actually, this is also our design of a simple 1-inch PVC pipeline that goes from the main as a service line into people's households. Spigot is a commercially available either galvanized steel or PVC spigot. And we didn't end up designing a holder or a stand to go around the pipe, around the vertical 1-inch pipe, because people typically just tie them to rods in our community or tie them even directly to the wall.
So we completed a cost estimate and construction schedule. Option one would take about 6 months to complete, give or take. The cost estimate to the right, option one is about $9,000. And the biggest expense would be the mainline pipe at around almost $5,000. Option two would take about 9 months to complete. There's a little extra pipeline involved in the system. The total cost would be around $15,000, so much more expensive than the first option. As you can see, the mainline pipe is near almost $10,000, and this is because there's an extra, as Lynn had already mentioned, line running parallel to the pie line that's about almost 3.5 kilometers long, so it really drove up the price. So for our final recommendations, we are going with design option one. It is less expensive, and for these kinds of projects, every dollar counts. It has an efficient layout. It is a little less reliable than the second option. However, through EPA net modeling and other data analysis, we can see that there is enough pressure to get the water to the top of the hill and then down the hill at the end of the system. This is assuming that people aren't just continuously letting their taps run throughout the day and they're aware of the system and its maintenance procedures. So in terms of maintenance, we are also recommending that the water committee be more involved. We're suggesting that maybe they collect into small taps in order to keep up with maintenance fees and that. And they also need to closely monitor the chlorine. It was too difficult to monitor in EPA net due to certain things we did not take into account while we were in Panama. So we devised chlorine test sheets for the community to test the chlorine along the system in order to ensure there's enough chlorine. And if not, go from there. So to conclude, the community of Vallecito is a traditional Latino farming community. They had existing aqueduct systems in place, however, they were failing to meet the needs of the community and its growing population. So we devised a new aqueduct system for them in order to ensure a clean and adequate supply of water. And we felt that it must be practical to construct and also maintain, and we feel that these options are. So we would like to acknowledge, of course, our Peace Corps volunteers, as they were very helpful when we were in the community. We'd like to thank our senior design advisors, of course, as they gave us plenty of help throughout the semester. And then we'd also like to thank Team Agua de Abajo, as they did give us supplemental survey data. Here are references. Thank you for coming and listening to us talk about our journey. Are there any questions?
Well, it's good to hear your voice, but I don't think you talk in professional practice.
I did.
But it's good to hear. How often this chlorination? You know, they're kind of a fascinating system just drop in those, you know, how many tablets do they drop in there? How often do they have to do that?
Well, depending on the height of the tablet stem, you could have 4 or 5 tablets in there.
And so then as they dissolve,
as they dissolve, they drop.
So how long, how often do they?
A tablet, depending on the flow going into the system, can last up to like a week, maybe a little more. So they probably have to change, go up the big hill and change it about every month or like.
They would need somebody to.
Yeah, probably someone on the water committee or someone that lives nearby.
So help me out here, a couple of clarifications. So the spring box is not connected to the tank at this time?
Not at this time.
Okay.
They both exist currently. They're both by Peace for Volunteer, but they're not connected. And it doesn't serve anybody.
So nobody's using that, okay, because the storage tank's empty. Are they gathering water from that spring box? The spring box isn't connected to anything?
Nothing.
Right, even in the picture, there's just.
They're just running out?
Yeah.
Okay.
As far as, it is on someone's private land, you know, I mean, everything's on someone's private land at some point. But he's not using it, I think he's using a different source.
So this, Lynn, can you go back to your graphic and explain where it connects to the existing system and key into the existing system? So help me out here. I got confused. So option one is the line that you had surveyed that may or may not get.
Yeah,
it'll change.
Option one is what we surveyed when we were there. We surveyed all the way from the tank to the town center.
Along, it's
really hilly. We were along a hill the entire time. However, when we came back, we found out that they might not serve the town center with that system, so I guess they just want to run the pipe all the way to the top of the hill, but not down the hill to the town center. And there's some existing, I guess there's an existing line somewhere down here, and they plan to develop that more and tee it into the system that we want to build, and then that system will serve the town center and all the houses.
For the majority of the houses. So you're picking up 6 houses.
It's just 6 houses with this line right here.
Okay, and so their idea is to connect the spring box to the tank, right? And then and then at some point tie in this existing line that runs.
Yep, it's just pretty much this is like up a hill and this is about parallel, like down a hill, down the bottom of the hill along the river more.
So the good news is that our surveying line is the route that we surveyed is definitely going to be used. Just not the same way, you know, in reality it's probably going to be this. We're not really sure why she picked this option, but in our estimates it's going to be about 50% more expensive to take probably a couple more months to build.
If they put a new line in the whole route.
if they use this option too, so that one serves only the 6 houses at there's a hill right there.
Yeah.
And then they tee off here and serve all the houses around that. And we're tying into an existing.
And you're assuming that they're going to have to put a new line in there, Victor?
We don't know how much of this system already exists.
Right.
We estimated for our piping.
And that's why it's more expensive.
That's why it's more expensive, because we're assuming, we know that they're going to have to add more pipe down here. So it seems they're just building 2 lines, the way we see it.
Yeah, even our Peace Corps volunteer, had we had more time, we would have been able to see some of these existing systems for ourselves. But even our Peace Corps volunteer didn't have all of them mapped out perfectly. She just kind of had rough estimates on the map.
I was glad that you two noticed and gave Victor the rock and not the book to write. I was very proud of your decision there.
It was a train wreck. Sometimes water would just come out of the.
I mean, when we were surveying up this, you can move like a meter at a time because the elevation difference was so great. Water would be coming out the top of the rod. That's why it took us so long to survey.
Bell struggling and getting this. That was about the whole adventure.
Does anyone have questions besides Dr. Madeline?
just out of curiosity. Of that water coming out of
We really didn't see it at or anything in there. We didn't have a chance to actually go and take samples, which is one of the reasons why we couldn't model it in EPA net, because of that bulk. The chlorine, sorry. We have no idea what the source water is like. We can only go on an assumption that it's spring water, so it must be somewhat clean, not filled with dirt and other stuff.
Do the Panama standards match the World Health Organization's water standards, or no?
You mean for the supply of 30 gallons per day?
No, the quality of the water. What kind of treatment you're giving it?
Well, I'm sure they would still say, and I think it's pretty universally the zero coliforms and E. coli standard. Is that right, some of the environmentals? That's pretty universal. The World Health Organization standard, right?
The World Health Organization's primary one is pathogen. They don't care much about whatever else, not like EPA.
Oh, you're talking about turbidity and metals and whatnot. We, unfortunately, we didn't see the source water just out of time constraints, but we can assume it was the Peace Corps volunteer that built it. Had done conducted some of those tests, right, since he had built the storage tank and the spray boxes. It is a pretty hefty project, it looks like, not as small as well.
And just like based off of research, a lot of these gravity fed systems usually they suggest having like a 0.2 parts per million residual chlorine concentration, so that's kind of like what we went off of. We didn't really go off of the standards per se, just because I have no idea what it's like, what it's at already. So we just kind of modeled to get to that point, I guess.
Was used for CP for your initial price?
Well, again, we kind of just based it off of research that we did, and a lot of them said that they must be at least like 2 milligram minutes per liter. So, let's see, since the storage tank would vary throughout the day, assuming that it's like at its lowest peak, I think we calculated like a retention time of about 2 hours. So that should be enough time for the chlorine to react. And plus the pipeline itself, before it reaches any household or anything like that, is relatively very long since all the households are at the end of the system. So I guess the major concern would be if there's enough chlorine coming from the chlorine tablets itself. So, but the time for it to react would be sufficient. I guess is where we're at.
30 gallons a day, pretty generous.
Pretty generous.
And an awful lot of logging camps. If there's a logging camp, you may gain in the shower every day, you would still have 17
to 20. Yeah, 30 is quite high, but we had the capacity to do it. So.
Yeah,
because we would have cheated more if we didn't have the supply.
The guys that we traveled with, they didn't even bring like bottles of water. They just used oranges to drink. They were shedding near the stuff. Oh, you must be exhausted, but I don't know. So
I'm sure you had a work plan before you got to the field. The plans changed.
Yeah.
What surprised you the most that you didn't anticipate in terms of your work when you were in the field?
As far as the survey itself?
Whatever. General.
What would you guys say? Surprising? I don't know. It was very muddy. Besides that, it just the amount of care you have to, you really have to pay attention with the water level because it's, you know, it took a long time, you know, to go down or up a slope, depending on how severe it is. You can only be moving sometimes a meter or two between the two rods so that the water doesn't come out of the tube. Yeah, you just always have to pay attention. You can't have long conversations about whatever because you're just watching the water level, measuring and reading out the compass readings.
How many days were you in the field?
We were there for a week, but there were 2 days that we didn't do any work.
About 4 to 5 days.
I spent 5 days, okay, at the water level.
do anything because we didn't have any guides. They were all working, so we had a day off.
We had some local people with us because we were just going through the jungle, so our Peace Corps volunteer didn't even know where we were sometimes, and they would just, I guess, know the land and be macheting out the path for us.
Now your parents aren't here.
Good thing.